What is education? The picture here is, of course, anyone who's been in my classroom knows, this is Raphael's depiction of the School of Athens, Plato's School of Athens, the Academy. This is where the process of education is happening. This process is social. Messy, disputatious, and yet it certainly appears to be purposeful, and one could presume productive, given Plato himself has been a best-selling author for something like 1,400 years. I think the picture on the left is even more interesting. This is the product of education. Look at it. The mind at work and play in the universe. Free, confident, skilled, focused, entirely human. So if I asked you in one short and simple sentence to write down what you thought education was, definition, this is education, I rather doubt that we would come up with the same response. Given how long this process has been going on, it strikes me as a little strange. But perhaps not. My story. The most important event of my young life, perhaps the most important event of my entire life, came completely out of the blue. It was the school year, 1970-1971, and I had been transferred around to different schools. In the eighth grade, I was in one of these large brick warehouse schools with no windows. And I was a little moat trapped in the machinery of education, utterly indifferent to my fate, to my thoughts. I found myself in a classroom, many classrooms, that seemed pointless, half-hearted at best. I particularly remember my English teacher. I don't know her name. She seemed rather old to me at the time, but let's assume she was probably 26 or 7. It's all relative, isn't it? Completely inadequate to the task that had been presented to her, to bring life, hope, and meaning to that room full of sullen, suspicious, ignorant, and entirely unwilling subjects. I suppose I was one of them. One day, with no preamble, no context, no explanation, no follow-up, nothing, no connection to anything that I could see or know and have never been able to retrace, she walked by my desk and dropped a book on my desk, looked at me and said, "This and this only, I think you should read this." It was Walden by Henry David Thoreau. Now, this gift should not have worked. I don't know whether you have read any of Walden, but it doesn't rest on any young adult literature bestseller lists. Not everyone recognizes the moment, the precise moment in their life when their identity and their purpose flashed into focus. I do. Just a short sample from the book. Remember, I'm 13. I come from a working class family. My father was functionally illiterate. He was an orphan from the Great Depression. There were no books in my house except what I bought for my lunch money. And yet I took this book home and read it. Thoreau says, "I went to the woods because I wished to live deliberately, to front only the essential facts of life and see if I could not learn what it had to teach, and not, when I came to die, discover I had not lived." At 13, I'm reading this book, and it sends me into some kind of internal exalted state. I began to learn things and think things. Let's take a look. A person's truest state of being is in inside. The world outside is mysterious and demands our full attention. Reality is not obvious. As a Harvard College graduate, Thoreau already knew many things, and yet he deliberately retreated into a state of ignorance about the world, living for years in a one-room cabin and apparently doing almost nothing except a bit of gardening and lots of walks. Why would he do that? This simple, uncluttered life gave him space for thinking and the possibility of finding truth. Finding the true shape of the world is the most important thing a person can aim for. That this truth, once found, might be unsatisfying and inconvenient is simply of no consequence. Truth is truth. Also, as in the incident when he was locked up for protesting the Spanish-American War, I learned that a person, having found truth, must bring it into the public world and activate it. What had possessed this woman to drop this book on my desk? What is the extent of what can be accomplished inside a classroom? Well, one thing I know, that learning is a human thing. Humans learn from humans. At that point, I didn't know much more. So I set myself to answer that question. I'm still in the process, after 31 years of teaching and a few years of doing some other things. Back to Aristotle. Now you say, wait a minute, when did Aristotle come up? Well, you remember the picture previously, the young man who was in vigorous disputation with the old man, that was Aristotle. And the old man was, of course, his famous teacher, Plato. Aristotle believed that education was excellence. Now, please stop thinking about run faster, jump higher, as they used to say when I was 8 years old and buying PF Flyers, tennis shoes. This excellence had nothing to do with competition, which Aristotle would have sneered at and thought to be entirely unproductive as a means of discovering something important. So I'm better than you. What does that say? No idea. Rather, it was a kind of focused and efficient self. A person who performed acts of living with exceptional competence and internal dedication. It was the art of living freely chosen. 1,000 years or two ahead. The zero-sum game. Hobbes called this, called life in general, the war of every man against every man. Competition is our true state of being, the only possible state of being, and that there is a single fixed amount of social good that exists and will always exist, and the only function of life is to grasp as much of this as possible and hold it, successfully defend it, such as higher education. We have somehow, bizarrely, managed to allow ourselves to be convinced that there are only perhaps, what, 30 schools in the world where a person can receive an adequate education, and the rest of them are chicken crap. Rather silly, don't you think? Some view education as a conveniently organized future customer base to be managed for future returns. If these potential customers are carefully constructed and managed, they can guarantee happy stockholders and endless returns for decades to come. Then what should we as teachers do if this is true? Well, should stand aside, applaud, and let the process go on. As the economist Victor Lebeau stated in 1955, he said this, Our enormously productive economies, he's writing about 1955, demands that we make consumption our way of life, that we convert the buying and use of goods into rituals, that we seek our spiritual satisfactions, our ego satisfactions in consumption. The measure of social status, of social acceptance, of prestige must now be found in our consumption patterns. The very meaning and significance of our life will from now on be expressed in consumption terms. Others believe, see human nature as essentially dangerous and anarchic. Improperly regulated humans are to be feared. Classrooms, education, are instruments of orthodoxy. Orthodoxy produces stability. Nothing else matters. To people who hold this point of view, any change to the present, cultural, political, economic, is unthinkable. The question is, what are my aims? Who do I work for? What do I work for? Do I work for truth or consensus? Those are not the same. Do I work for stability or creativity? Do I partner myself with the generation of wealth or prosperity? The fact is, truth can be troublesome and creativity can be destabilizing. The most important, the most revolutionary technology is in the form of ideas, not objects. Was it the printing press or was it the ideas? Was it the books? Was it the minds? Was it the restless questions that found their way into these books? The creative mind and the orthodox mind. Now, as my father used to say when I was a kid, son, if you aim at nothing, you're bound to hit it. So, what do I aim at in my classroom? The orthodox mind cannot create. It doesn't actually think. It recites. Push the button, the loop starts. Push the button again, it stops. Push the button, the loop starts. The creative mind works because it sees things that are invisible. Go to sleep at night, just as I did after reading Walden. You wake up in the morning, you open your eyes and look around, and you see things that simply weren't there the day before. And things that were there the day before, that loomed on the conceptual horizon, get smaller. Things move around. Values change. That is, the value that I assign to this or the value that I assign to that. It is not a corporate activity. It is not an industrial activity. It's a mysterious process. It's an organic process. Let's consider the Brazilian education reformer Paulo Freire's famous quotation. Education either functions as an instrument which is used to facilitate integration of the younger generation into the logic of the present system and to bring about conformity, or it becomes the practice of freedom, the means by which men and women deal critically and creatively with reality and discover how to participate in the transformation of their world. So, what do you know, Mr. Self, after all these years? Well, I think truth is worth having. And I would like my students to achieve excellence so that they may be useful and they may find a measure of stability. I would like them to discover and embrace their obligations so that they might be truly free. Thank you.